fun, okay? They really are. Another part that we need to think about with the red blood cell, because iron is so important to the red blood cell, how is it that we handle iron in our bodies? How do we get it? Our food. We have to consume it. Now, anybody in here ever been told that their iron levels are low? That you might be partially anemic? Okay? There are cases where the body just can't metabolize iron and people are severely anemic. There are times that with anemia, you can be given iron pills, okay? When we take in iron, our body really has to utilize that substance, okay? We actually are going to see that when we take in iron, we take it in two forms. There's Fe2+, Fe3+. Fe is the chemical symbol for iron, okay? The stomach acid hopefully will convert the 3 to the 2. We gotta have something called gastroferrin that's gonna be present in the stomach. What does it show gastroferrin doing?
Binds to it.
Binds to the 2, okay? The gastroferrin can transport the 2 to the small intestines, where hopefully it'll be released for absorption into the circulation. If we get it to the small intestines and we see that we're going to have it released into the circulation, in the plasma of the blood, there's a protein called transferrin. See how they're trying to represent it in the blocks here? They're showing the iron in the circles. And if it's transferrin, what do you think it's going to be doing with the iron? Transferring it somewhere. Okay? So it'll pick up the iron. Hopefully, as we circulate to the liver, we'll release the 2. We can store it. But to store the iron, okay, we need another protein. So the protein that will attach to the iron in the liver, we've got ferritin, okay, and we've got this apoferritin. The binding to the apoferritin, when it gets stored, is now termed ferritin. So transferrin brought it in, dropped it off, we get it attached and stored in the liver. What we're going to see, anything that remains, okay, 2, we make it to other organs, the 2 can be used for making hemoglobin, myoglobin, etc. So when we talk about a key nutritional requirement, iron is definitely a critical nutrient in our diet. We lose iron every day. We lose it through our urine, through the feces, through bleeding. Men lose about 0.9 milligrams per day. Women, about 1.7. That's because, once again, we menstruate, okay? If there's a low absorption rate, like for example, if you're told that you have that issue, you might have to consume more per day. But because iron
the ability of the body to metabolize it the way it does, we do have to consume anywhere from 5 milligrams or above. It could be up to 20 milligrams per day.
So does that mean iron is fat soluble?
Iron is gonna not dissolve like what you're thinking as being fat or water soluble. When we think of, now, if we think about it in relationship to the fact that we might take in 20 milligrams per day, but we only need to use 15, the 5 milligrams that's going to get left over from that digestive system, the way the digestive system is going to take care of it, the digestive system, well, in the digestive system, it'll go on to become feces, and it will be part of what gives feces the brown color. Okay, if we make it into the circulatory system and it doesn't get used in the kidneys, it will be reuptaken, and the kidneys will make it a part of the urine, and it's part of one of the things that gives urine the yellowish brown color. Okay, the actual getting it into and out of the cells, we need a little bit of help.
Yeah, because I see it's like transferred over
yes.
to the blood plasma.
So we're going to need a little bit of help for that, to get it in and out of the cells that'll need it, okay? Or in the body itself, getting rid of it either in the digestive or in the urine, okay? That'll be done by, believe it or not, liver and kidneys. Then that by the metabolizing that they'll do. So saying water versus fat, it's actually both components. So it's really difficult to say, you know, yes or no to either one.
Okay.
So this dietary iron that we take in, okay, like I just showed in the picture, we take it in two forms, in the three and the two. Hopefully, in the stomach, we'll make it to the protein, the gastroferrin, we'll transport it to the small intestine. Hopefully, it'll get absorbed in the blood with transferrin. We'll transport it to areas that we need it. Now, it'll transport it to the bone marrow. It'll transport it to the liver. It'll transport it to other tissues, for example, skeletal muscle, okay? If it gets transported to the bone marrow, we're gonna use that iron for hemoglobin synthesis. If we transport it to muscle, especially skeletal muscle, okay? Skeletal muscle is going to use it for myoglobin. Now, what does that tell me? Myo means muscle, but what does globin tell me?
It's made up of protein.
It's a protein globe, so it wants to hold something, right? So in this case, if skeletal muscle uses it for myoglobin. Myoglobin is how the muscle is going to store oxygen. Why would the muscle want to store oxygen? And it gives it a reddish color also.
For exercising?
For what?
Because the muscle's going to need to work, so it needs oxygen.
It's going to use oxygen how? What process?
Respiration.
Cellular respiration. In other cells, now look what happens in most of all the other cells. Well, in most all cells, period. Iron used for cytochromes in mitochondria. Ooh. Oh. Do
Do you happen to remember cytochromes in the mitochondria? Probably not. But guess what they do? They are electron transport molecules. Does that ring a bell? NADH, FAD, NAD, FAD. They transported it to the electron transport chain. Y'all remember all that? Yes, you do.
Kind of.
They would shuffle the electrons to the electron transport chain, and then those electrons would bump down the electron transport chain, and as they had bumped down the electron transport chain, hydrogens crossed over, created a gradient, and those H pluses moved down the ATP synthase and became ATP. Y'all remember that? If we're going to store it, there you go, liver, which we already looked at. Something that's going to help with erythropoiesis, red blood cell production, vitamin B12 and folic acid. Something that you've probably heard, okay, like if you're thinking about getting pregnant or if you're pregnant, okay, make sure you take the folic acid. B12, that's just one, and we kind of deplete that with stress and so forth, okay? Vitamin C and copper, these are going to be cofactors that help with making hemoglobin. So those are other nutritional supplements that become important in the body. Okay, we're going to stop right there for today. Take a break. Back at 12:30.